Hello, thanks for coming to my talk. So far I've seen amazing talks during this conference. Thanks for the organizers. Some of the things I will be talking about have been explained already, so I see it rather as an advantage than a disadvantage, so I don't have to re-explain everything. So that's what my talk is all about, program description-based programming. Program descriptions have already been mentioned, and I will also talk it into the context of point-free programming, which has been mentioned already. Yesterday we saw this fantastic talk about impractical Lambda calculus. Well, let's hope that mine is a little bit more practical, right? So about me, in my previous life, I was indeed a mathematician, a programmer, an early Mona transformer contributor together with Derek Mayer, which maybe some of you might know, may know. About my current life, believe me or not, I'm retired. I'm still a programmer, but also a cyclist climbing mountains, a gardener in my greenhouse, and last but not least, what I learned today, no, yesterday actually, I'm also sleeping a lot, which seems to be the next big thing in the programming world. So maybe that has an impact on what I'm going to present you. Changed this slide yesterday, of course. So, an introduction. So this talk is about a library within Dotty, say Scala 3. And it's actually part of the Dotty build because I'm pushing the type system a little bit. It's inspired by the programming language FP. Maybe you don't know it, but maybe some of you know John Backus. He was a Turing Award winner back in the 70s, and he did his famous talk, Can Programming Be Liberated from the Von Neumann Style? And, well, somehow he illustrated his idea with this language FP. So let me first ask a question, what is this? Hopefully, well, you know, maybe it's a pipe. Maybe it's a painting describing a pipe. Maybe I'm just showing you a slide describing a painting describing a pipe, and this can go on, right? Maybe this is just a screen on which this slide is projected, and so on and so on. So let's embrace this idea of describing things. It's certainly not a pipe. And indeed, it's a famous picture of a Belgian painter, Cécine Pain-Pipe. Probably many of you know it. It's from René Magritte. I'm from Belgium as well, by the way, but I'm not French-speaking. Okay, so let's start with this is not a program. And let's try to explain, nevertheless, that it kind of looks like a program. At the outer level, it looks as if it is an if-then-else, but the if-then-else are in backticks, not to confuse them with the keywords. So if, well, whatever, probably my input argument, my argument is zero, then I return one. And in fact, I'm also saying it's not a function, it's kind of an arrow. Think about it that way. Otherwise, I have this, and this is really kind of exciting, I think. I have this Haskell-like let-in construct. So what I will do is I will subtract one. I will explain it actually point fully. I will subtract one from my argument and then chain it with my this is not a program. And as a consequence, think about programming is more than just chaining functions. If you think about it carefully, from time to time you need local vals in your method body. And this will construct this local val, which is the result of applying, so to speak, my this is not a program to the arguments where I subtract one from it. And so now I have two things, and I multiply them, right? Okay, so indeed this is not a program. It's Dotty coded describing a program, or maybe, if you will, specifying a program. It's a program description, program specification. Like, think about it as programming to an interface. Can you think of a meaningful name? Could somebody think of a meaningful name for that program? Come on, if you followed the logic or not. Shall I go back? So, if my input argument is 0, I return 1. Otherwise, I subtract 1 from it, and I will say it recursively, apply my program to it, and multiply the corresponding. So, multiply my original. So, the whole point is my original is not lost, and I can multiply it with my recursive call. Come on. Ah, okay. So, not everything is lost. So, in fact, that proves to me that it's not so impractical that at least somebody recognizes factorial even though it's not called factorial, right? So it's a fact factorial, right? And that's how I would specify factorial. But it's pure syntax. There's no semantics attached to it at all, right? But it's kind of readable. So what are the aspects of this program description? It's point three. Components are closed boxes. It's simple, simple in the sense that there is this big difference between simple versus complex and easy versus difficult. But it's simple from a syntactical point of view, because that's a syntactical notion, it's simple. I also, well, you may think it's difficult, so which is a semantic notion, right? But here's my point. Understanding difficult stuff once and for all isn't that big fun. So let's try to understand it once and for all, okay? And I've explained it a little bit, like behind the scenes, I'm instructing a local val, which then can be reused afterwards. So that's a big difference between normal composition, where your original argument is lost, right? It's still there. John Hughes, in a famous paper a long time ago, said like it took a long time before the functional programming community had a solution for local variables. That's actually a pure local way to introduce local variables. More about that later. So this would be the point full alternative, and I was scared to use flat map here, so I used bind. It's a little bit tricky, so okay, now I have my Z, I open my box, that's the whole point, I have white box reuse here, I open my box, I apply a 0 to it, bind it to the value B, and then I have a real if then else, and so on and so on and so on, okay? So, what can I tell about this one? It's four-pointful, components are open boxes. I find it more complex, okay, let's face it, purely syntactically it's more complex. Therefore, in my opinion, it's inherently difficult. Human brains can only deal with, as opposed, by the way, to computers, can only deal with a limited amount of complexity. Okay, it's not so complex. And you know what? Encountering complex stuff over and over again isn't fun at all. Okay? But more important, it's wrong. Where is the error, right? Now I'll point you to the error. Do you see in the multiplication the Z and the Y flipping? I did it deliberately. And of course it's easy to fix. But the point is with all those variables around, especially if you don't give them meaningful names, you might easily make errors, okay? So that's one of the points I want to make as well. It's my personal opinion, but basically that's the way I made an error here. So explaining again that maybe the more complex your program is, the more kind of errors like those ones are lurking. So what's my choice? In my library, I will provide a powerful computation, so let's say Kleisli composition API for the library developers, because yes, power of expression is important. And I will give a slightly less powerful program API. Think as computations, as monads, think as of programs as arrows, to the application developers, and I have flavored it with these nice if-then-else and let-in constructs. And that's where Scala really shines, because you can make these DSLs right from the beginning. Okay, DSLs are interesting at the application level, at the infrastructure level. Maybe you have a nice DSL for, I don't know, event sourcing. But why not starting at the bottom? Warning, by abuse of notation, I'm going to say, and I've already did, I'm going to use program instead of program description, but okay, no. Hope it doesn't lead to any confusion. You often see these kind of things in mathematical papers as well. Okay, so here's my main thread. My main thread is, well, what is the type class defining those? Let's call them arrows, but more informally I will call them programs. Functions are programs, okay? So we're in the functional programming world, and you can actually use functions as much as you want. You don't have to write everything like this, just drop it into a program, right? So everything is reusable. Of course, they compose. I can construct things. I can have conditional logic, and then I'll put it in a separate line. There is something like aggregation as well, but aggregation is more like a property of a data structure, but I can actually do some magic to say, like, okay, everything I do with that data structure, I can do it at the arrow level, at the program level, rather than at the function level. So that's my main trait. And they correspond one-to-one with these FP forms from Backus, Jan Backus. Okay, so rather an influential idea that he had, I think. And I dare saying here that for me, this trait describes the essence of point-free functional programming, and maybe even the essence of programming. That's maybe a little bit of an exaggeration. Okay, so what are the differences? Well, they both promote point-free composition-based programming. Composition in many senses, it will not only be sequential composition, right? But FP is a language, so MPDP, PDBP, Program Description Based Programming, is a library. As a consequence, I remember in one of the talks they said, like, you know, JavaScript is not a framework, it's just a language, that's a good thing. Well, here, this is just a library, it's even a better thing. FP is heterogeneous, PDBP is the library is homogeneous, and it's all about passing programming capabilities around. FP has language fixed semantics, while here that's the whole point of it. Semantics is completely detached from the syntax. Fixed capabilities, unless you extend the language here, you can extend it yourself. FP I/O is impure, and of course I describe my I/O, so it's pure. Of course, eventually, like we all know, I/O happens, but it's kind of pushed to the boundaries, to a certain run function. How comes? Well, FP is function level and PDBP is category level. That's the real reason, right? So let's talk a little bit about the foundations. Programs, I see them as generalizations of functions. And let me tell you the next bullet, which in my opinion is the most sensible definition of computations. CFR monads, they're generalized expressions. And think about it, functions are defined using expressions, and my API, well, I use monads, well, Kleisli functions, to actually define those arrows. This is, for me, an important slide. Think of it, an expression is evaluated to a value, a computation is executed to a value. Monad is just a generalization of an expression. It's more like a tool which I want to use in my library than to expose to my programmers. Okay, this is a somewhat controversial thing. So I will have values like this value program from Z to Y. I always start from Z because one day or another, if you start from X, Y, Z, one day or another you need four variables. So you can all the way go down all the way to A. I will, and this is very controversial, write it like this. Z to Y, why not? Because it is transforming a Z to a Y, and if it happens to transform an A to a B. I call it A to B. And this helped me a lot with understanding types in complex expressions, because they just fit together. It's controversial, I agree, but nevertheless, I will do it. There's another reason. And think about functions for a moment. Can you think of any pure function from Z to Z for all Z? Give me one. The identity, right? Is there another one? In fact, no. All right, so there is only one pure function from Z to Z. There is only one pure function here, which is a first projection. There is only one here, which is swapping the arguments, right? It's all in sync with this, and this can go on. It's all in sync with this theorems for free thing, right? And let's face it, suppose I want to extract from a nested tuple something like the second one in the third nested, how would you call that? Maybe even, well, although that is also a complex expression, at least you show what you're doing. But it's controversial, I agree. Okay, so now this is interesting. This construction, so this let in thing, the construction of local variables, is in a very mathematically sound way, so Curie, Howard, Lambeck has been mentioned already as well, equivalent with categorical products. And in fact, by writing a program that converts one to the other and the other back to, you actually give a constructive proof of it. In the world of categories, right? Which is, isn't that cool? Just this little program proves that they are category, in a categorical sense, equivalent. So if I have a Z to Y, let's explain the let again. And from a Z, I can construct a Y, a local variable Y. And with that original Z, it's not lost, remember, and that new local variable Y, I can construct an X. Then from Z, I can construct an X. Does it make sense? It took a long time. It was a paper about arrows of John Huge, which kind of said, okay, this is the way we deal with local variables. And then actually also talking about impractical lambda calculus, there is also arrow calculus, which is not so impractical, but which which is explained by Phil Wadler, where he shows that arrow calculus is the, I would see more like a computation engine between all this, underneath all this, but I just don't want to see those variables. And they are not SKI combinators, right? I hope they are a little bit more practical. If then else and let in, they are relatively practical, right? But they do their job, and in fact, in some sense, they are related, but I don't even want to go into those details. In the same way, are conditions equivalent, provably equivalent, by writing a program, by writing a constructive program? It's all about constructive mathematics, right? With categorical sums. So, if and else logic, categorical sums, well, within the world which I've specified within that programming world, right? Of course, you need functions as, you somewhere will need functions as programs, for example. It's not true in all categories, of course, right? Well, how could it? Same thing, I have some kind of predicate, I have a true and a false thing that yields a Z from a Y. I turned the Y and the Z now because it's kind of dual, and then this if then else thing will do the trick. I don't even think I have to explain that. It makes sense, right? Okay, so what are main programs? Main program is, well, it will probably make use of something like, hey, out of the blue, maybe by reading a socket or something, or by reading something from a database, I can produce a Z that is the argument of my program. And the other way, then if my program, and then, well, You could argue, why not having the third bullet simply from Y to unit? But remember, maybe I don't only want to kind of write out the result of my program, but also the argument. So here it's really fundamental that my argument is not lost. I would like to write the factorial of 1 is 1, okay, or something. So, as a consequence, you can indeed do this let thing, And I have a fully untyped thing from unit to unit. How do I look at those fully untyped things? And it's also a choice, maybe not the best one, but actors are also fully untyped. I think of it more like an architectural artifact. I have those little things, and then I will deploy them, and maybe this one writes to a socket, and the other one reads from that socket. Okay? And so that I don't need those types, right? Well, you could argue that even that maybe you could make this a little bit more typeful, like also Akka has been made a little bit more typeful. For the moment, I simply do it like this, okay? So Factorial was actually code that was written in a class, right? Where a type class where I'm requiring the arrow to have the programming features, right? And I implicitly import them, and maybe I have some helper function, because if zero is, of course, a helper function, is a helper program, excuse me, but which is actually a function wrapped into a program and so on. Right. So what I need to do is, of course, make implicit instances of that program to really make that work. So let me first do my first demo, which is a factorial main, but I'm still doing my reading and my writing. Remember, out of the blue, an argument, and then kind of writing it to def null or wherever you want to write it. Let me just give my first demo. Okay, so here, I think it's number one demo. Okay, in fact, I run it already, but I will do it again. Demo run, so I have many demos. I'm not going to give them all. Oh, what did I do? Oh yeah, slash too much, sorry. And it will again give me my menu. Don't know why this takes me, okay. So one, and type an integer, 10, and here it is, okay? Now, what I did, first of all, I implemented, and in fact, in this case, trivially using functions, of course, because functions are satisfying this, but I will augment it to do more than that. Let's do the following. Let's feed it with 1,000, all right? Oh, did I do? Okay, maybe I was too fast, but I think it's good. You see the one and then the three zeros? All right. This will give a Stack Overflow. But hey, the same program with slightly different semantics can also be run in a tail recursive way, but I need to provide another implementation, which is my number three. No, not a reading. It's where is the other effectful one? I didn't even... tail recursive, number two, sorry. It's number two, okay? So I do this one, and let's leave dangerously 10,000. All right? Baf, here it is, right? And it's reasonably fast. I used big numbers, of course, to be able to do this. And all the zeros are, it's natural that you see. I can scroll if you want. What's the big deal here? First of all, I have used another implementation, and the magic behind it is that I, in my main program, and it can be the last line before running the semantics of my program, I because that's what I will always write, run semantics of my program. So I have these layers, and the semantics is two layers. I will tell you about that later on. I do an appropriate dependency injection by import. That's it. An implicit dependency injection, and that these are the only lines that I have to change for switching to this tail recursive one. It's the same program description. And so, in fact, these are the two which I've shown you, okay? How comes? Well, it's the same program, other dependency injection by import. That's it, okay? And I should have written other implicit program dependency injection, program instance. Okay, I'm just using another program. What is this doing behind the scenes? And that's the two-level semantics. Of course, you know how to do that. You trampoline it. You build a data structure on the heap. But if that's not something that you run, because then you see your heap. So then there is an extra natural transformation, which is effectively folding that tree in a tail recursive way. And you know what's so funny about it? My first implementation, I could annotate it with tail recursive, but then, and you will see that later, I added effect free and effect free reading and writing, and I had to add extra pattern matching things, and it wasn't tail recursive anymore, and I asked to the Gitter guys more specifically, Guillaume Martres, he's my hero, because if something doesn't work, I can't continue anymore with my Dotty, but he solves things in nightly builds. He's really my hero. And he said, no, look, you don't have to annotate with tail rec. It will do the tail rec where it can do it. Isn't that fantastic? So indeed, maybe I can show you already. It's a little bit in advance, but why not? Demo run. And I will do the same with pure input-output, which is number 4. To console writing, reading a begint, and I'm writing to console. Maybe my names are not the best ones. These are just package names for easily finding out what I have to do. And so this one will use pure I.O., which I will explain in a moment, the 1,000 is good enough, I guess. Buff, okay? And this is really cool in the sense that the tail recursion happens where it can happen without even annotating it with tail recursive. Okay, next slides. So how do we introduce reading? I will use a mouse for it. Out of the blue you read something, right? But maybe you would like to read right in the middle of your program. Well, then you just forget about your Z. U stands for unit. And I have to tell a little bit about this chunk here. I'm using call by name parameters. I would like to use, of course, lazy parameters, but they are not in Dotty yet. If they will ever be, I don't know, but I'm doing this chunk trick, okay? Which is kind of a lazy way of doing things. Okay. Writing, same thing. I need something which is writable. Think about a monoid. And I just write to unit, okay? Now, what is this thing? Well, sorry for the notation, but this is just an alias for implicit functions. Dotty has this new feature called implicit functions, and I like this, I don't want to use that keyword, I simply say it's an implicit function. And so if I can implicitly transform my input to something writable, I can also kind of write my Z. It's a little bit similar to a toString. So think about this as if there is a toString. If it's for the Haskell guys, if it's showable, okay? And you see the implicitly actually happening here. Therefore, my question about implicitly, when I did Dotty code with 2 implicitlys in, he sometimes complained about these ambiguities, but anyway. Okay, so let's do that one. In fact, I did it, okay? And I did it in a tail recursive way. Okay, so I can skip this. Now, this is an interesting one, logging, because I want to see what is happening. And here's my new method, which I call writing or while writing. I didn't want, so you do your work while writing what is happening. And so think of it as follows. I do have a program, and I can convert my input to something that is writable. So, for example, some logging information. I don't want my output to be writable because, well, maybe then I'm already have to execute my function in advance. Maybe with some defer or something, I could think about it, but anyway, like this loop, like in Haskell, it wouldn't work. But anyway, then I can write implicitly writable, this thing I convert my input to, then I can actually do my thing logging. And well, it's just not too well. Don't really look too much at that code, but that's the implementation. And so then, for example, I have some info data structure which shows interesting information, like when did it happen. And so I can now wrap everything using this little info thing. Of course, I will also import, I will use other is 0 and other is 1 helpers, which are also locked. But it's again just a matter of doing the right imports or doing sometimes also doing the right extents. And I will do that same thing. So I will do the factorial with also writing info. Now. I'm not talking too much about what is happening behind the scenes. When interesting choices have been made, for example, for reading, of course, I'm using, and you could even think that the reader monad is a little bit obsolete here. I'm using implicit functions to implement reading. I also used implicit functions for writing for the toString. But since I want to have a uniform framework, I still use the reader monad, so to speak. Which one is it? To console writing and factorial main? I think it is 7. Yes, 7. And let's just type 10, and then it will also do logging, okay? See what I mean? And exactly like you would expect, okay? That's the only thing I need to do. I just wrap this into this info. And that's the most configurable thing is the thing you program. You could say like, okay, maybe you should really put that in another file, but it's so convenient to actually do it programmatically. Oh, sorry. And it's actually, again, in this sense, it is orthogonal to your program because it's only another import. Eh? It's only another import, and I have to agree my program's changed with these info wrappings. Okay. All right. State, same thing. You are going to read state and you're going to write state. Okay, so let's skip a little bit and let's look at randomness, right? And so, of course, I can maybe, when I have a seat as a state which changes, then I can start doing random things like in property-based testing. And, I have an integer which is reading my modified seat and then turning it into a random begint. Natural number, if it's negative, I negate it. And random, which is completely trivial, I do modulo 100, okay? So don't look at this here, but I say a random factorial multiplied by a random multiplier, and that's actually this here. Isn't that cool? And in fact, now I'm using products instead of the let, because I need two things. So here's my random, which I feed to my factorial, and at the same time, I'm doing a random and I multiply. That's it. Can't be simpler than this, I think, right? So let's see. And in fact, I do it twice. Because the semantics, if I run my function, it's not just unit, but it will be my C transformation, so I can do it again. All right? Let's try it. You can all help me with finding the right thing to run, random. It's number 6. And now I don't need input, right? Because the random generator will run, and it's okay. Random factorial multiplied by random modifier, and the next time it's something else, okay? That's it. So it's kind of different than the SKY combinators, I think. But it's readable, right? Oh, sorry for that. I'm using a copy-pasting to highlight things. Okay, so I did that. Failure, okay. So again, like always, we are going to switch from this Java world where you have real exceptions to something where you wrap them in a success or failure. So you probably need a success and a failure. Not going to go all too deep in the details, only a few examples. Then I have a try-catch, which actually wraps the real exceptions into this world of success and failure. But I also have a corresponding try and catching, which does something in the world of success and failure. Because sometimes already in this world of success and failure, right? I try to mimic as much as possible normal programming languages so that my program descriptions look like normal, between quotes, Java programs. So here's my failure divide. Try to divide and catch with a zero divisor failure, right? Let's see if I can. I'm not going to do all of them now, right? So maybe the recover, the try divide main. Do you 14, yes, I think it is this one. Thank you. And I'll divide 6 by 2, for example. That should not be a problem. Oh, and I do it writing again. Okay, I combine that with a logging so that you see what is happening. More about that later. And then, for example, I'll show the code in a moment, the recovering one, okay? So I recover, for example, with some, well, if I divide by 0, I recover with a max number or something. Whatever, it's just a demo. So let's see, 17, and then I have, I should first do the failure. But then, okay, so then I will do the recovering, I will do the recovering, which is also 6, 2, which is also working, but then I do again the failure, and I do the recover in the failing case. Okay, sorry for that, forgot. So the only, it was the 14. Please help me because it's just, and then 6 divided by 0, and you see failure, what it's actually doing, or 0 division failure, and I actually wrapped it in something else, okay? And the recover, which I will show the code of it in a moment, is the 13, and I have 6 divided. Oh, sorry, what did I do? I did the wrong one. Thank you. 17, 6 divided by 0, and then, okay, I'm recovering. Max value success, which then I'll put in, but whatever success it is, right? And then the division is this thing. Of course, silly code, but for example, it could be used, which I will show in a minute. So this is the failure divide, failure factorial. Well, here, in fact, you do the work yourself. You actually do this failure yourself in if-then-else logic. But if then you try to recover from this one, you do it with a trying, because you are already in this failure, success-failure world. But anyway, okay, demo, recover divides, recover factorial, I'm not going to do those. Latency, parallelism, by the way. I'm going to introduce, in fact, this par product has almost the same signature as a normal product. The difference is that par product doesn't use call by name stuff. The sequential product does, because maybe the first one fails. But that's basically it. I have two arrows from Z, one from Z to Y and one from Z to X, and I have one from Z to Y and X. This is just a type alias for a product. Or the par compose, which were Z to X and Y to W, then I have a Z and Y to X and W. This is really composing arrows in parallel, right? And an async, which is, well, the easiest way to define one is to use the identity for one vote, but of course you can optimize. So let's write Fibonacci the stupid way, not optimized to make it, but to at least, well, instead of this is here, I will subtract 1 and 2 from my arguments, right? I don't do that in parallel, but the only thing is I have a parallel operator for this one, okay? And that's the only thing which I, and in fact, I also combine that with my logging so that we see what is happening. Behind the scenes, by the way, I'm switching from, maybe I should open an editor here. But how do I increase the font? Sorry for that. Preferences or something? Editor fonts? Okay. Select. Something like that. And instead of working with type Z, sorry for that, I'm doing the following. What's this called? This is a callback, right? And this is a callback handler, right? Sorry. U is in unit, huh? So I'm switching from here to here, so to go reactive. And I have to all my basic operations of my program trait, I have to implement it here, and of course I will do it using actors. I'm not going to reinvent the wheel, right? I'm just doing that using actors. Okay, I will actually prove that I will prove, illustrate that I will do it with actors, but first let's run it the normal way. So I have the Fibonacci main, which is 18. Now I'm not going to use large numbers, otherwise there is, you know, too much invocations. So let's type 3, and you actually see what is going on, right? But there's more. And here actually, object orientation, I don't even dare mentioning it, but shines because my implementation itself, I can use in kind of overrule my basic operations so that they also show a little bit about the implementation if I want to really log what is happening at the implementation level. And I've called this one info writing Fibonacci main, which is number 19. And let's do the same thing. And now you see, well, behind the scenes, I'm using actors, so I'm doing a par compose and then join again or something like that. And I don't do println, by the way. I use my writing logging framework to also log those things. And then you see, for example, that there is a par compose for 2 and 1. There is a left part doing something. There is a right part and stuff like that. Okay, and then it all joins together. This is certainly not a way to optimize Fibonacci, but it's just to illustrate, right? Oh, sorry, that's my code. All right, demo. Control, and that's an interesting one. And here behind the scenes, and in fact, it's also the API, I'm using delimited continuations. What is a continuation? Well, if from an X, I can continue to from an X I can continue to a Y, and from a Z I can continue to a Y, then in fact, well, look at it the other way around. If I can go from a Z I can go to X, then I can compose it with the X to Y to get a Z to Y. The Z to Y here, the Z to X, if I compose that with the X to Y, I get a Z to Y. But this is the opposite direction. That's a very fancy way of controlling. So that's a way to work with continuations to consider a function from Z to Y as transforming continuations, right? Now, how does this work? Maybe some of you know delimited continuations. Well, and that's a nice thing. In order to implement it, I have to implement what is actually what a machine is. And I have to push frames on a stack. But since they are delimited continuations, I also have to push prompt on the stack to say it's only this part. And so I really have to implement that. I looked at the Haskell implementation and just did the same thing. Behind the scenes, that's happening. What is nice here is that I can get rid of my prompt. It's an implicit prompt, which makes, again, the API interesting for my users. So what is my example, this one here? And in fact, I again combine it with logging, but let's look at this here. So I wrap everything in a reset. That's, well, maybe a little bit unfortunate. I first do my add one, and then I shift. And look at this thing here. Well, this is just an alias for shifting of begin. I can actually switch, use three types here, but anyway. But I didn't, and I shift actually to do this block. And think about it as follows. I first do the add two, and then there is this underscore where I plug in this thing. So then I do the add 3, and then I shift again, then I have this thing, where I do the add 4, where I plug in this thing, that's the add 5, right? Then I do the add 6, and then I do the add 7. I did it on purpose, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay? Let's do a demo. Hey, sorry for that. Yeah, just a second. So I'll just do the demo, okay? Sorry for that. And I will immediately also do the info writing. Info writing, writing, begin example, right? So that's number 9. And I'll type an integer 0. And now you see, okay, I do my reset at 1, shift 1, at 2, at 3. Then I already at 6, shift 6. At 4, comes a 10. At 6 and so on, all right? Okay, that's it then. Thanks. Any questions? Maybe about the implementation or about some other things. Actually, I didn't show aggregation, but you can do aggregation. I did it for least fixed points of of functors, typical thing, right? Yes. I don't know that language. Which was it?
The concatenative languages. No.
Sorry for that. I don't know. Another thing is, hey, I don't really want to reinvent the wheel. I have written all my specification packages, all my specification code in specification packages, and behind the scenes you can use cats if you want, but I wanted to do my own thing. Okay? Well, I didn't do all my own thing. I used delimited continuations. I used actors. And in fact, if you look at how Eric Meyer wants to introduce, so we have latency, what is it, failure, how he wants to introduce uncertainty, which we talked about yesterday, using the same principles, I could reuse this code there. Okay. Okay. Thanks so much for listening.